This is Michael Ouellette of Double Helix, and had the unique experience of playing a whole bunch of KI recently, and a lot of folks have been having a lot of questions at home in regards to some of the characters, and I've actually had a lot of things that I really wanted to talk about. So one of the things that recently happened was an announcement that Killer Instinct was going to be a free-to-play game on Xbox One. You can download the game for free. Jaga was going to be playable, and at that point you would have to pay money, and people were using the term nickel and diming for other characters. What exactly is going on with the process of Killer Instinct?
Yeah, so unfortunately that was just kind of an error in messaging. Essentially what the deal is there's going to be multiple versions of the full game at launch that guarantee you specific amounts of content as it's released over the course of our season. And we're going to call them seasons. So different editions that have different like special stuff that we're going to announce later, different shows like Evo. But on top of that is we wanted to give like the casual player and people that are kind of intimidated by fighting games, like the opportunity to play without feeling like, hey, I had to fork up full price in order to pay, or to play, I should say. And so the idea was, we're going to release our demo with Jago and all the single player content and all the online multiplayer that's at launch for free. So you get to play the game, check it out, do everything with Jago that the full version guys can do. But then on top of that, you're like, hey, you know what? I got to play this game, I really like it, but you know what, I don't want to get those other characters. I have no interest in those. Yeah. So you also have the option to purchase those characters without buying the full game.
Okay.
Now obviously the full game would be more like, you know, a flat rate. That's what makes sense.
A lot of people were asking.
We don't expect people to pay into the hundreds of dollars just to play the full game of season one.
Whatever.
Yeah.
Whatever the roster ends up being. I think that was where a lot of the confusion was happening.
Our goal is to not nickel and dime people, it's to grow a community, so.
There you go. Oh my God. So as far as when it comes to like this stuff that might be available between like season pass or what you guys were saying about seasons and things like that, is there a possibility that we could potentially see things like original character costumes like eventually available or like downloadable content? I don't want to talk about DLC before the game is out really, but thinking about the original costumes in the characters in this game seems really exciting to me.
Absolutely. So what we want is community feedback. Like, tell us what you want to see in upcoming seasons. And we want to be able to go out and, like, see, like, what does everybody really, really want, and then push forward for that stuff, for that content.
That sounds great. So if you guys want to see original costumes, like, if you have a problem with the way a character looks, put a comment below and say that you want original costumes. If the game gets enough support, I guess we might actually see something like that in the future.
Absolutely. More characters, more arenas, more features, whatever you guys want to see.
As far as the soundtrack goes, Killer Instinct, the original games, had a pretty iconic soundtrack. Between the first game and the second game, those tunes are kind of like so memorable to myself between Robert Bienlund designing them. Does he have any involvement in this game?
Yes, actually Robin listens to all the music that's being produced by our new composer, Mick Gordon. He's from New Zealand. He's been known to do like the Dead Space soundtracks, Need for Speed, very prolific work, and he's totally awesome. So Robin basically gave his blessing after hearing Mick's demo, which was for Tiger's Lair, which is completely amazing.
That's Jago's theme, right?
That's Jago's theme. So as you can hear, like, all the like really Buddhist themed like audio and the chants, and we thought it was very primal, and Mick really wanted to get the essence of the fight and remain true to like the origins of the character, that very Tibetan feel. So he went to his local Buddhist temple and they taught him how to do the guttural, like, oh, like all the, yeah.
That's pretty cool. I was noticing even when you guys put up the character art of Jago, how he had a lot of inspiration from all these different Tibetan cultures.
Yes.
And are we gonna see more artwork like that showing where the character's inspiration comes from?
Absolutely. So it's a long process, and we take 50% of the past and then 50% of what's new. Because what we want to do is remain true to the roots of Killer Instinct and what those characters mean, but we also want to evolve them for like the modern, sophisticated audience. So our take on Jago is like, let's embrace the Tibetan monk. Let's really dig deep into what that means. So it's like from the tattoos that he has about the tiger spirit that he's inflicted upon himself, to the gear that he's wearing, even to the style of sword that he has, they're all Tibet and reminiscent of the tiger spirit. So the way the cloth folds, you can see like the tiger stripes kind of there, like his knee guards are like tiger's mouths are open and clouds. So
I was noticing all those little details, and I was at first seeing Jago and I was like, it doesn't really look like Jago, but then I actually looked at the design document you guys put on the website and I was like, oh wow, his backstory is like insane. It's like way different than previous Jago's. It's way darker. So a lot of the design decisions made a lot of sense at that point.
Yeah, so I mean, I'm not going to dive too deep in the story, but essentially we're taking off after the events of Killer Instinct 2. So you have a character like Jago, who's basically had a crisis of faith because he found out that the tiger spirit that he believed he was following was actually Gargos and manipulated him, right? So how does this martial arts like being like reconcile what's happened to him and how he dedicates himself to his training and to his craft as being a warrior, right? As reaffirming, what is the tiger spirit to me? And what does that entail? And like he kind of, like all our characters are gonna exist in the gray, basically.
That's sick, because you guys are putting a lot of thought behind the backstory of the previous games, because when I think of the backstory of Killer Instinct, I'm like, Ultra Tech is an asshole. It's kind of hard to understand like where the characters are coming from, and now you're giving this real deep backstory connected to the mythology of the previous games, and it feels really thought out, if that makes sense.
Yeah, we want to put meat on those bones, that's so it's compelling. So,
Is there any word about, I see a lot of people asking this, where the hell did Saberwolf get arms from? Because in KI2, we had robot arms. Can you say anything about that?
Yeah, because you guys have seen the character's designs. So essentially what happens in his story arc is, for him, it's about finding this lost humanity and doing whatever it takes to be a man, but he has this crisis between the beast and man. And so he's like abandoned technology, ripped these cybernetics from his arms, and he's turned to like the dark arts, and he's trying to become a person again. No matter what the cost is. So he's ripped these augmentations out. He's regrown his arms. There's going to be some cool story elements that are revealed once we showcase his stage.
Even though Glacius isn't playable right now, I'm really looking forward to him too.
Yeah, he'll be playable at Evo.
Nice. It'll be at Evo.
And that's when we're also going to do our next character reveal.
With the new console that Killer Instinct is on being the Xbox One, there's been a lot of rumors going around that the system might not be best for like running tournaments because of the Kinect sensor requiring to be on and, you know, Xbox go away or Xbox go home while a tournament's happening. Is the game being considered for like tournament viability? Because a lot of people seem to be really excited about KI coming back, and I really want to see it played live and in person with a lot of folks.
Absolutely. Tournament viability is a huge goal for us, and we have partners within Microsoft that are going to work with us to make sure that we can get that to happen.
That's amazing.
Yeah, so as a developer and we want to grow a community, it's absolutely essential that the community we're after has the ability to play it with people.
So it seems like you guys got some pretty deep roots in the fighting game community and the history of fighters and how things have gone with like Evo and things like that, right?
Yeah, we do. We have guys that have worked on Weapon Lord, Street Fighter 2, Turbo, Hyper Fighting, Super Street Fighter 2, Skullgirls as well. So we have a lot of guys that have worked on fighters or just love fighters in general.
That sounds pretty cool that there's a huge culmination of talent coming together to put something like KI together. And one thing I wanted to ask you personally, and I like asking a lot of the devs regarding their game, what's your favorite new feature? Because KI introduces a lot of new things as far as like the fighting game system in comparison to previous Killer Instincts. What's your favorite new feature in KI?
Oh man, besides it's in 2.5D and it runs at 60 frames a second.
That's pretty good. Take a shot, guys.
I actually really like the way that we've incorporated our juggle system and in the elegancy in our breaker system. And anyone who gets a chance to play at Stella's, if this is posted by then, or if you got to come to the show and play it, like you're playing like version 1.0 of our breaker system. We really want to make sure that this game is all about that two-way interaction. And it's super fun to play. I mean, I can't express it enough. Like when we have like animators, VFX artists, like guys that you wouldn't typically think in game development are like really like gamers. These guys love our game. They love playing it. For us, it's all about accessibility, but then making sure that we have the roots in there for the tournament scene, that people want to keep coming back to the lab, figuring out, hey, what's the best way to maximize or to bluff someone into a bad break and really blow them up. So
we just got off a big session on stage during the Mad Cats live show, and it's pretty exciting to see like a 30-hit combo come on the screen. People just blow up in the crowd. It's one of those things that I like in this environment because not a lot of people know the move lists and the availability of the Ultra, so when you see that stuff happen, it's like an arcade again, and you see everyone explode.
Yeah, it's absolutely magical. Like I said, this has been a dream job for a lot of us, like beyond our wildest dreams, and so we're so happy to share it with people and then basically get the community involved. I think it's the greatest thing that ever happened.
I think that's what everyone wants to hear. So thank you very much, Mike.